Let's take a closer look now at North Carolina, which has had the highest hurricane death toll of any state so far. The western city of Asheville, in particular, has been devastated, with flooded roads and loss of power essentially cutting the city off from any outside aid. I'm joined now by Gerard Albert III from Blue Ridge Public Radio in Asheville. Gerard, thank you for joining us. What can you tell us about what you're hearing from people in Asheville, about what you've seen yourself, about the conditions there, and what folks on the ground need?
Yeah, so as the kind of water is receding and people are cleaning up roads, the biggest need in Asheville is water. There is no running water in the city. So that is showers, that is flushing toilets, that is, of course, drinking water. So the water is definitely the biggest need.
Tell me a little bit more about what you're hearing from folks on the ground there. I mean, how prepared were they for this storm, and what are they going through right now?
Yeah, not very prepared. I don't think anybody thought it was going to be like this. Everybody that I've spoken to, whether they've lived here 3 years or 30 years, has been telling me that, you know, I've never seen anything like this in the city or the region. Water was up to people's, you know, up to the ceiling in their first floor homes. It was taking trailers down river. It was just such an inundation of water that people are shocked. And right now, since the cell service is so spotty, people are having trouble getting in touch with their friends, their family, their loved ones. People are wandering around the streets basically trying to find service or a Wi-Fi hotspot.
You covered the visit of the governor and FEMA officials to Asheville today. What are they telling you about when some of that aid, when water will be able to make its way in, and also why they weren't better prepared in terms of pre-positioning some of these materials?
Right. You know, in their visit, they stress that help is here. They're doing what they can. But I think it feels so slow because some of the roads are still not traversable, even by these rescue vehicles. I mean, I've seen bridges to neighborhoods completely destroyed. Residents have made makeshift bridges to get supplies in and out. But, you know, the federal government, the state government, the local governments, all of them are still working on rescue missions. They are getting water out into places that they feel need it. They are going to the hospitals and making sure they have power and they have water, because that was an issue too. And one of the biggest hospitals here, Mission Hospital in Asheville, doctors would do procedures and couldn't wash their hands afterwards. They had no sterile equipment. So now they have some of that, according to the governor.
What are you hearing from folks on the ground about the cleanup or rebuilding ahead? Do folks want to stay and rebuild?
I think people want to stay. A lot of the homes that were destroyed and washed away, it's like this in many of these storms, where the trailers, where the homes without that solid foundation. But honestly, it still feels like rescue mode here, even though it's days later. Recovery is not something that a lot of people have been talking about at all. It is still rescue mode. It is still trying to get in contact with somebody, trying to find water, trying to find food. It's not at the recovery stage just yet.
You mentioned the issues with connectivity. What does that mean for people on the ground being able to even find and connect with their loved ones to make sure they're okay?
It's extremely difficult. I myself was stranded for 4 days with no cell service. I had gone out about an hour south of Asheville to cover the storm hitting a more rural area of North Carolina, and I could not get in touch with my bosses, with my family. I didn't know too many people in the area. It causes anxiety, and I had a place to stay, luckily, but for people that maybe don't have a place to stay, it's just a very anxious time. People are on edge. People are worried, and it's getting to the point where they're kind of getting to their wits' end with the lack of food, the lack of water, the lack of being able to reach people. And on the flip side of that, we've seen communities come together. We've seen neighborhoods form bonds and clear out roadways with people who have chainsaws or larger farm tools, like some people in the rural areas do. So there is a coming together in person, but still being able to reach people. Even on Facebook, all we see in the neighborhood groups is people asking about their loved ones in the area that they just cannot reach.
We are all watching with worry and holding everyone in Asheville in our hearts. That is Gerard Albert III from Blue Ridge Public Radio joining us tonight. Thank you so much for your time. Please stay safe.
Thank you.